thanks. Thank you so much for the invitation. I really enjoy being in this conference. I listened and enjoyed to all the talks before, and thank you for your kind introduction. So I, you know, taking your advice, I went to the kitchen to refill my coffee, and my wife was cutting onions, and so when I got back, you know, a little bit of flavor got into my eyes. So if you find me emotional, it's not for being here. I love being here, but it's really the onions that's making me do that. So thank you so much for being here. Greetings to everybody. I have nothing to disclose. What I'm going to talk about has nothing to do with the other things that I do professionally right now. But I have to admit that I took some, you know, I took some of the pictures from social media and Google, etc., to add to this presentation. So without much ado, let me start. There are two takeaways. There are two things that I wanted to make clear in this talk, if possible. One is the regulatory requirements that are involved in developing a clinical test. Now, clinical test is really a tango between IVD manufacturer and the clinical lab most of the times. And they're both governed by different regulatory rules and obligations. And I wanted to give an example and demonstrate how the IVD manufacturer, you know, takes the regulation and does its thing versus how a clinical lab does that. In other words, FDA is generally who regulates IVD manufacturer activities, and CLIA is what governs clinical labs. So how do they interplay? That's one thing that I wanted to demonstrate using this example. So you know, we all lab result. We only see the tip of the iceberg. We see the numbers, and then the doctors providers take those numbers and do the clinical utility with that. But underneath the surface, there are innumerable things that are going on. Reimbursement battles. There is this alphabet soup of FDA, CLIA, CMS, CAP, COLA. Then there is a validation, verification. So I'm going to try to piece some of these together. So hopefully by the end of the talk, you would see some of these things surface up. So let's see if that works. So let's look at, in the lab medicine, we talk about brain-to-brain loop. So a physician orders the test, and then the sample is drawn, the specimen is drawn at clinician's office or hospital or where have you. And then it's many activities happen to document that, and then the transportation happens, and then the sample comes into the laboratory, and there again there are documentations that go on and some processes before it is passed on to the actual testing. Then the analytical phase. In the analytical phase is where the actual testing happens, and it is these testing devices that is regulated by FDA at the manufacturer's site. So I covered this. Did I cover this all right? So what I wanted to say here was that there are a large number of alphabet soup and other, other activities going on and under the radar. And then in my talk, by the end of my talk, I hope to have some of these bubble up, some of these alphabet soup will hopefully be put in the right places. So I was in the slide when I had to go back. In lab medicine, we talk about brain-to-brain loop. So the physician orders the test, and then the test is, the sample is drawn and it goes through a series of steps in documentation and gets into the analytical, into the laboratory, where again, it is subjected to many documentation and processes. And then it goes to the actual testing. And then after the testing, once a number or a test result is generated, then it goes through the post-analytical phase back to the physician for clinical utility. So there are, we could break them down into three pieces, pre-analytical phase, analytical phase, and post-analytical phase. So the, we learned that in the analytical phase, the instrumentation itself is often regulated by FDA. But as you can see, lab test is a lot more than that. So I don't want to go into this because Alan previously described this so much in detail and so much better. But FDA basically regulates the IVD devices based on whether they're class one, low, based on their risk, and they have different classifications. All this was covered much, much better. So I'm going to move on from there. So what all this means is that the test results, when we see the analytical errors that are generated from the analytical instruments are really a tip of the iceberg. Most of the errors in lab medicine happens in pre-analytical phase or post-analytical phase. So this is, to the other side is the is a diagram which is generated by Professor Pavani on the contribution of different different errors. So as you can see, pre-analytical errors can be about 70% of the errors that happen in lab, whereas analytical errors are a really small fraction of that. So controlling just the analytical phase is not sufficient, right? So a test method constituted of a large number of things like sample collection processing, stability, analytical method, the quality protocol, all the way, many of these are covered by the QMS. So there is a whole slew of things that need to be regulated in the laboratory. So I'm going to try to try to define that process a little bit, in a very brief manner. So in a clinical lab, the IVD manufacturer provides test kits or platforms or devices, and then labs themselves can sometimes develop lab-developed tests. So most labs use probably about, I would say, 70 to 90% of the tests that labs do are tests that are purchased from IVD manufacturers. But labs often sometimes have to develop their own lab-developed tests. So labs can produce, so these tests that are performed in the laboratory produce test results that then go to clinics and hospitals. So FDA, in a sense, really have the authority to oversee the whole process, but what they focus on is really the clearing, the IVD manufacturer process. So, clearance and approval process that Alan explained so well before me. So, FDA has deemed that authority to Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services because they're responsible for they're the payers for Medicare and Medicaid, and so they have an interest in overseeing the clinical lab activities. So they essentially, CMS essentially oversees the rest of the process. They do that through some agencies such as CLIA. So CLIA is the Clinical Lab Improvement Amendment Act, which is designed to oversee the lab quality. And this is administered through states. So if the lab is in Massachusetts, then CLIA would be administered by the state of Massachusetts. And in addition, there is the accreditation agencies that a lab need to have, and these agencies must meet or exceed exceed the CMS's criteria for quality. And so a CAP, the College of American Pathologists, is a prominent accreditation agency. And then there are the others such as COLA and Joint Commission and so forth. So it is through this circle of these agencies that the rest of the processes are regulated. So back to the IVD manufacturer. So IVD manufacturer, when they develop a device, they need to validate the device, validate the method in which to test the device, and then test, optimize, and characterize the device for validating its performance metrics. So all this is done under the guidance of FDA at the manufacturer. Now, such devices, then they enter the lab, labs adopt them, and labs then perform something called a verification. So verification is a process that is governed by CLIA, and it's a much simpler process compared to validation. But when labs develop their own tests, they have to go through a complete validation, somewhat similar to the what IVD manufacturers have to go through, but different, which I will describe with the example. So this validation in the lab is governed by CLIA. So there are, CLIA offers a lot of guidance through agencies such as CLSI for the labs to do their validations. So what happens when lab purchases devices that are not FDA approved? So if you can manufacture devices that are not FDA approved and give it to the labs. So in that case, those are primarily, they can be called research use only kits. So those are then given to the labs, and labs take them and develop them as lab developed tests. So labs have to completely CLIA validate them, and that's how they use those kits through the standard process that I described. So that's kind of, I hope this gives an idea of how the labs and the manufacturer, they are regulated differently. So why do labs, labs can either adopt manufacturer's assays, or they can develop their own assays. Why do they do either one? So when a kit is FDA approved, the risk is shifted to the IVD manufacturer. So it's so much easier for the lab to simply adopt a FDA approved kit, because all they need to do is verify their claims, analytical claims. And usually those are standardized and they're cheaper to implement. That's questionable, but in many cases. And there are automated platforms such as immunoassays that are easy to implement as well as easy to operationalize. Why do labs develop lab-developed tests? Oftentimes there are no tests available from the manufacturers. It's not feasible economically for them to develop it, or it's some niche development that the lab like to make. Additionally, labs can also implement some of these assays at home in order to save costs of sending out. And then they can do it for quality control reasons. And also if they want to differentiate from other labs, by offering some novel tests, it is very likely that, there is nothing out there that that they can adopt. So these are reasons that they do it. And so, to give you a little bit of summary of manufacturer versus CLIA. So the goal of the manufacturer is to gain FDA approval so that they can mass market their device. So it's a high risk, the Roche or Abbott or who have you, when they develop their assays, their kits, they market it all over the US and across the globe. In order to do that, they need to develop in their facility under FDA regulation, they need to develop a test in order to test the kit or device. Then they need to, this whole process is inspected by FDA, and this can take years. I've been I've worked for manufacturers where it would take 1 to 2 years, easily for a kit to be developed and FDA approved. So this is done through a QSR process. Again, Alan described that. So gaining FDA approval is tough related to a lab developing its own test. The business goal is, of course, to distribute across markets. In clinical lab, the goal is really to offer your own clients, add to the menu of your tests. You cannot distribute the test. You cannot develop a test and then start selling it. You can only, offer the test from your lab. And this is usually a small, lighter process. So clinical labs, as I mentioned, is inspected by CLIA, CAP, etc. And the focus really here, the main focus for clinical lab is to make sure that the assay is consistently, it performs consistently across time. So, if a patient has, a patient is normal, in the first month and nothing has changed 1 month from now, the assay should be able to, generate results that indicate that the patient is normal. So the CLIA validation process is a lot easier compared to compared to the FDA process, because the scope is narrower. It's to offer only to the lab clients. So here is some guidance from CAP that makes this a little bit more clearer. So what this says is that these are the different parameters, accuracy, analytical sensitivity, etc. If it is an FDA-approved test, then labs only need to verify them. And verification process is given below. For example, accuracy, the recommendation is about 20 to 40 samples across AMR. Precision is you only need to do about 2 to 3 samples across 5 days, as opposed to 20 days when it is a lab developed test. Or if you actually adopt a test, FDA-approved test, and then modify it, then you will likely have to consider it as a lab developed test and perform full validation in the lab. So instead of verification, you will now have to do validation. So to kind of cover what we just talked about, validation is to establish performance parameters. So you don't know what these parameters are before you go into validation. At the end of validation, you'll know, okay, my precision is 10%, or my accuracy with the existing method is 5% or 95% or what have you. Verification, simply take manufacturer's metrics and make sure that in your lab you can get the same results. So when a manufacturer applies for FDA approval, it's called validation, but it's done under FDA regulation. When a lab buys FDA approved kit, it's called verification. When a lab develop its own test, it's a validation, but by CLIA. So I'm going to give an example. Now we're going to move to a real example where I'm going to compare the validation by FDA, by the manufacturer and a lab of analytical specificity for this particular assay. I'm only going to, so the validation involves a lot of metrics. Specificity is one of them. I'm just going to take that as an example to make my point. So I'm going to compare these two validation by manufacturer, validation by the lab. So just to give you a little bit of background of what the assay is, the example assay is a liquid chromatography mass spectrometry assay of steroid panel. Shown here is the steroidogenesis pathway where cholesterol is converted to groups of classes of steroids, androgens and estrogens, mineralocorticoids, and glucocorticoids. And here we have 11 steroids that we would like to analyze. So the goal is to develop a kit that will analyze a panel of these 11 steroids by a manufacturer. And then we'll compare that to how a CLIA lab does it. So, why mass spectrometry? Because mass spectrometry is considered among the most specific methods available. You can multiplex. So in one sample, one injection, you can get multiple, you can measure multiple analytes. Like in this case, we are going to measure 11 steroids from one injection. And it can be cost effective if it is designed right. There's a lot of caveats here, but I'm not going to go into that. So why steroid panel? Because it's a steroid panels, endocrinologists, primary care physicians, oncologists, it is highly useful to measure panels of steroids for various applications. I'm not going to go into that, but just to show you that these are the market that that this is targeted for. Come to the actual technical aspect of the assay. So decision point in developing an LCMS assay. So you have to first extract your steroids from plasma or serum, and then inject the extract into a chromatogram, and you have to develop a method for that, sub-method for that. And then once it is in the chromatograph, then you have a chromatography method that will optimally separate the different steroids. And then what comes out of the chromatograph, you have to then take it into mass spectrometer through ionization. So you have to create an ion so that you can manipulate it electrostatically into a mass spectrometer. And it's a gas phase analysis beyond this. So then the mass spectrometry analyzes this ions that are produced, and then it's detected. So in this particular case, this is an example of the workflow here. So serum samples are processed. They're extracted using a sterile in this case, and then it's injected into the LC-MS, and then the data is analyzed, and then you have calibration curves and controls, and then you have your results, and that results are then passed on to your clinician. So again, so what is the specific? Why am I talking about specificity? Because LC-MS-MS is designed. The purpose of it is to offer specificity in addition to other other characteristics. So we talked about analyte extraction, injection into chromatograph, ionization, and once the ionized molecule enters the mass spectrometer, so mass spectrometer in this case has three quadrupoles. Those are Q1, Q2, Q3. So the first quadrupole, Q1, selects an intact parent mass of a steroid, let's say cortisol. It can select only the cortisol parent, and then the cortisol parent is then taken to Q2, where it is fragmented using a buffer gas, and the fragmentation produces fragments of the cortisol, smaller pieces. It breaks the bonds, and then smaller pieces are produced. Those smaller pieces are then used to analyze. Used to analyze the quantity and quality of the molecule. So this process is highly specific if you can ensure that what is entering Q1 and what is exiting Q3 are specific to your molecule. You have an opportunity here. Mass spectrometry is opportunity, not necessarily it's given. So in this case, in this method, what we have is a set of 11 steroids and their internal standards. So all of them have pre-selected Q1 and Q3 that we are interested in measuring, right? So what's the problem? Problem is that when we look at steroids that can be in a patient system, there can be up to 388 steroids that can produce identical Q1 and Q3, to match this panel. So we are faced with a huge analytical challenge of identifying and quantifying potential biological drug interference. So this is a challenge that manufacturer is faced with in order to apply for FDA approval. They need to show that their method is specific. That 388 steroids in the system, with all those steroids, they can still quantitatively analyze the steroids of interest. So this is a chromatogram of one injection. In one injection, you have aldosterone, for example, number one, that elutes first, and then you have progesterone that elutes the last, and in between you have all the other analytes. So how do you know that these peaks are not forming from one of those 388 potential interference? So take us back to the assay once more. So you have to extract the serum, and the interferon can co-extract with the serum from the serum, and then it can be co-loaded into the column and if it is not separated by chromatography, then it can end up in the same peak, and then the mass spectrometer can then it may have the same molecular weights, and so the Q1 will select the same. It can also co-select the peak, the interferon, and then produce a fragment that is identical to the one that we are looking for. So when all these things happen, you have interference. So you have to prove that your assay either has no interference or you know what's going on. So out of the 388 steroids, we were able to buy 124 of them. 264 we just couldn't even buy. And you know, purchasing that many steroids is a huge expense, right? But since it's mass marketed, it's for a company like Roche or Abbott or PerkinElmer, these are not that big. But for a lab, it's prohibitive. So the question is, how do you ensure that we are detecting steroids of interest and not the interferons? So using that 124 that we could purchase, we started studying the characteristics. So for example, what are the types of steroids that produce a peak? And what are the types of steroids that do not produce a peak? So if they don't produce peak, then that whole class of steroids are probably not interferons. But if they produce the peak, then we put them in the bucket of potential interferons. So for example, a 3-keto steroid does not produce an MRM peak, which means all the 3-keto steroids from our interferons list can potentially be, we could consider them to be non-interfering. So we can remove some of them. So this way, we had to systematically study the trends and structure relationship, in the structure retention time. How does structure affect retention time? If the structure is different, but their mass is the same, they may separate differently, and therefore, you don't have an interference problem. But if they separate if they co-elute chromatographically and enter the mass spectrometry at the same time, then you may still be able to separate them by fragmentation. They may fragment differently. So we had to study this behavior of subclasses of steroids, and then determine which classes of steroids can produce peaks and which one cannot, using the 128. And we were able to find out 8 confirmed analytical assay interferences. 8 of them, if they were present in the patient sample, they could produce some peak with our analytes of interest. Now, for the 264, we just had to transfer our knowledge from the actual experiments, and then estimate that out of the 264, we think that about 21 potential assay, 21 potential analytes could potentially interfere with our assay. So that's the specificity. That's what the specificity experiment gave us. Now, where do we go from there? To give you an example, cortisol, prednisolone is a common drug, and cortisol is in our panel. So they differ in 2 mass units. Prednisolone is 360, and cortisol is 362. Now, prednisolone also has an M+1 and M+2 isotopes. So prednisolone's M+2 isotope can be co-analyzed with cortisol. And we saw that they had the same retention time, and they had the same they had the same fragments. So that's a potential interference. So what do we do? We do a dose response study. So prednisolone was spiked in a sample without cortisol and at different concentrations, and we looked at the slope. So the slope of prednisolone as detected by the cortisol assay was about 1% compared to the cortisol assay, which is about 100, or which is 1. If you measure cortisol in cortisol assay, then your slope is 1. But if you measure prednisolone in a cortisol assay, you get a slope of 1%, which means one mole of prednisolone can produce 0.1 mole of interference. So that's how we can quantify interference. So this way, I mentioned that we had 8 potential interferences, and we saw that some of them were 100% interfering, which means 1 mole of interferent can produce 1 mole of signal, 1 mole of DHEA equivalent signal. Which means if you could never tell whether it is DHEA or the other interferon. So what do we do with that information? You can't, there's no magic here, right? You can't, these are there, people, these are present in patients. So that's where, again, how you deal with it, FDA does it differently than CLIA. So as I said, the method can take about 2 years to do, in this case, 5 to 6 people, and extensive characterization of specificity, like I mentioned. And so the kit insert will, in this case, report the results of all interferences tested and disclose the identity of potential interferences. Even if they're not tested, you'll say, yes, we think there are 21 interferences, we didn't test them, but they are potential interferences. Now, FDA can then choose to approve or disapprove based on their evaluation of risk and benefit. Now, labs, on the other hand, the entire validation that include the specificity can take up to, or it could be more, but you can do a LCMS validation in lab in under 3 months. Develop and validate. Validation in a lab could just be 1 month if you have everything else developed, but it can take several months to develop and validate. A shorter team, and for specificity, basically all you do is you look at the most important interferences, well-known interferences, and test them, and do a dose response study and demonstrate how much interference there is, and then how it is delivered to patient is really the important thing. So in lab, the lab director and the provider are to be in constant touch to understand how the assay is affecting the patient. So if a provider sees a result that doesn't make clinical sense, then lab director can potentially caution the provider that, hey, this it could be that interferon that we could not test. So that's how they would deal with it. So with that, I was a little conscious of the time, so I went a little fast, but please feel to ask me any questions. And I hope that you're able to understand a little bit of some of these alphabet soup that go into clinical assay. And I would like to stop there and open for any questions. You can always, I can provide my number or my email. You can always ask me questions offline too. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Harry. And we do have a question from you, from our friend Stephen Hall. He's the founder and principal of Hall Associates in Boston, not too far from you. And he asked a series of questions. He said, will the recent announcement that waives FDA clearance requirements for LDTs issued in context of COVID testing impact all tests more broadly? Is this a step backwards in terms of reliability and validity of IVD testing?
Yes, I mean, I'm a classical lab director. I feel anything less than, true validation of a new test, it will be going backwards. But in this case, this is a case where, government likely evaluated, there's a lot of need, the immediate need for the assay versus, perhaps you can lower the quality a little bit, but deliver, results to the masses. But yeah, definitely, quality-wise, I wouldn't be happy with what EUA allows labs to do. But I can also see the reason for it. Does that... I know that's a generic answer, but I can give you details of what, for example, specificity, you simply cannot, it can take a long time. The EUA, the genetic testing as well as antibody testing, what I mentioned is a lot more complicated as a high complexity LCMS multi-panel assay, but it would be a travesty if we have to go EUA on something like this.
Wonderful. And yet, like Harry mentioned, we can share his contact details for those interested. You can ask myself or my team, and we could do that after today's session. So once again, thank you so much, Harry.
You're welcome. Thank you.